马克·吕特，荷兰首相，1967年出生，1992年毕业于荷兰莱顿大学。2002年至2004年任荷兰社会事务和就业大臣，2004年至2006年任荷兰教育、文化和科学大臣，2006年6月当选荷兰自民党领导人，2010年10月14日就任荷兰首相。
Don't you think some of those bankers' salaries are too high?
I would be very cautious for government politics to interfere with salary setting within companies.
据统计，美国现在有56%的电视秀节目为真人秀，在年收入超过7.5万美元的18至49岁观众群中，收视率最高的25个节目里有10个为真人秀。如此火爆的一类节目，但却很少人知道它的鼻祖最早是来源于1999年荷兰首次推出的真人秀节目《老大哥》。
Go on inside.
从2000年起，该节目被陆续出口到58个国家，随后便诞生了美国版、英国版的《老大哥》、《美国偶像》、《英国达人》、《中国达人秀》等真人秀节目。回顾历史，其实荷兰人的创意是与生俱来的。荷兰的国花郁金香最初从土耳其引进的时候只有几百种，然而现在郁金香家族壮大到近2000个品种。不仅如此，荷兰人的智慧还帮助自己扩大了国土面积，他们通过筑堤、开凿运河、围海造田等方式开辟出了现在国家50%的土地。此外，荷兰人的创意还漂洋过海来到了中国，中央电视台新址的建设曾经在全世界范围内进行招标，最终的中标者是一位来自荷兰的设计师雷姆·库哈斯，他的此项设计曾被美国《时代周刊》评选为2007年世界10大建筑奇迹之一。
Mr. Prime Minister, it's a privilege having you with us.
It's good to be here.
Have you visited Beijing yet since you assumed office?
No, I've not been there as Prime Minister. I have visited Beijing as a state secretary for education. I believe it was in 2006.
What about the creative industry? There are a lot of creative talents in the Netherlands, even the new headquarters of the CCTV.
Yes, Rem Koolhaas. We are extremely proud. It's one of the landmark buildings now in Beijing. Is it now finished?
It's now finished. It's a $2.5 billion building. Yeah. But these are originally Dutch ideas, but the great Dutch ideas seems to have to materialize in other parts of the world.
Yes, and luckily also here in the Netherlands, but we are still very proud that we are able to spread the gospel of our creative industry and at the same time take, for example, the TV format. We in the Netherlands have a very strong TV sector with lots of innovation. And firms like Endemol some of these other TV format industries, they are making use of the Netherlands as a trial market and then exporting TV formats to other parts of the world. So the Voice of Holland, the Voice of America, so when I'm now visiting New York and I see a big announcement that tonight will be the new episode of the Voice of America, I feel very proud. Hey, this is a Dutch invention, and it started out on Dutch television and has now been exported to other Big Brother. I mean, it's not always high culture. It can also be the real mass TV is something which has started here. Take note of, and then they come to the Netherlands to use this market as a sort of trial market for new ideas, new inventions, and that helps then again to reinforce this stronghold we have in the creative industry.
有人说，17世纪的阿姆斯特丹就是今天美国的华尔街。荷兰人成立了世界上最早的联合股份公司东印度公司，垄断了当时全球贸易的一半。他们建起了世界上第一个股票交易所，资本市场由此诞生。 他们率先创办了信贷银行，发明了沿用至今的信贷体系。不过就在阿姆斯特丹最辉煌的时候，爆发了人类历史上最早的一次泡沫经济危机。十七世纪三十年代，一种郁金香球茎的价格曾经在三年里涨到原价的5900%，然后在7天内暴跌，导致无数人破产，荷兰也逐渐丢失了自己在商业领域的垄断地位。随着时间的推移，虽然由荷兰人开创的商业规则依然影响着世界，但是世界的经济中心早已转移到了美国的华尔街。现在从华尔街延伸出去的金融网络足可以覆盖全球，然而华尔街对利益的疯狂追逐却让它重蹈了荷兰当年的覆辙。2008年次贷危机爆发，经济泡沫破裂，全球经济陷入了一片愁云惨淡之中。华尔街银行家们一手接过纳税人的救助款，一手还为因危机而离职的银行高管打造丰厚的黄金降落伞。调查显示，华尔街各银行高管在2008年底依然拿到了和金融业繁荣时期持平的分红，总额高达184亿美元。美国总统奥巴马怒斥道：“华尔街银行家的行为是无耻的，他们就像贪婪的肥猫。”对此，现年45岁的荷兰首相马克吕特也提出了自己的看法。
If we go back into history, we can trace back the roots of many financial vehicles and institutions within the borders of the Netherlands. But the question that's weighing on the minds of a lot of scholars and regulators is that, looking back at the crisis and the ongoing crisis, what's your systematic view of the financial operators and how they have contributed or derailed or hijacked the world economy?
We need the banks, we need the financial institutions. They provide money, they provide loans for investments, so they are an integral part of your economic system. At the same time, you should not be naive. So it is good that at the moment in Europe we are implementing more rules and more oversight of the financial sector. That's one of the lessons. But I would argue that the crisis in 2008 and 2009, the Lehman Brothers was the first, basically, the first casualty of that crisis. And what happened later on in 2008-2009, the analysis is broader. There are issues around your own currency, which is probably too low valuated at the moment. There is the fact that in America it was too easy to get money. The interest rate was too low. So you had a whole bubble of money being pumped into the economy, and you were crazy not to invest, even if the investment itself was not that strong. And the idea behind the investment was that well thought through. You had the housing bubble in the United States. And all this had to come down and these troubles had to emerge. And the banks had been too easy to take out loans and to accept accept collateral which was basically not up to standard. So that whole bunch of issues has created the big blow in 2008-2009. Yes, there is a part of this which is due to the fact how the banks and the financial institutions.
Don't you think some of those bankers' salaries are too high? I saw a photo of you and Obama discussing together. Would you share some of his, what the media calls, the class warfare sentiment?
I believe that it should be up to the supervisory boards, to the non-executive directors, to the shareholders and the stakeholders of a company, of a bank, to decide the salary. So there is a difference when that particular financial institution is saved by the state. For example, we had to buy ABN AMRO in the Netherlands, which is at the moment, I'm happy to say, again, a very strong financial institution. But we had to buy ABN AMRO in 2008. And when the state has to invest so much public money into a financial institution, it's only logical that you have a view as a government on how high the salary should be, how high the bonuses should be, etc. But in general, I would be very cautious for government politics to interfere with salary setting within companies.
In China, whereas it seems that precisely because of the attraction of so much money, of exceedingly high pay, at these banks. All the talents, all the social resources are going into the financial sector.
Well, we had the luck, I think, that in our financial sector, the pay was good. It was not that good in the midst of the last decennium. So in around 2005, you would earn a very good salary with ING, ABN AMRO, Rabobank, or with some of the other financial institutions. But the salaries, the starting salary, for example, I started with Unilever after I left university. The consumer goods firm, and I worked there for 10 years, and my starting salary, and I believe it is still the case, was very competitive against the salaries which were offered by the financial institutions. So, and even the government, not the government itself, I mean the public sector, pays very good salaries to people who leave the universities. And it is important to have this competition for talent. In the public sector, in industrial sector, and in the financial sector. And this is something you can, well, basically organize.
Let's take
even the companies can do that. In China also, if the companies pay enough, they will be able to compete with the financial institutions.
欧债危机仍现僵局。 如何终结这场危机的蔓延 成了欧元区各国最纠结的问题。 不过，欧元区在成立伊始 就给这个问题打上了一个并不容易解开的结。1999年欧元区成立，很多国家经济发展水平都不在一个起跑线上。例如，德国1999年的GDP为2021.24亿欧元，人均GDP为24,304欧元，而西班牙在当年的GDP则是5799亿欧元。 人均GDP为14,525欧元，具有明显差异的几个经济体却硬要绑在一棵树上，这无疑是给欧元区埋下了一颗定时炸弹。欧债危机爆发，希腊、爱尔兰、意大利等国家像多米诺骨牌一样，一个个倒下，救助成了欧元区唯一可走的路。Die
Reaktion in Form des Gesetzes bedeutet nicht nur, dass wir Griechenland helfen, sondern sie bedeutet, dass wir damit den Euro als Ganzes stabilisieren und damit auch den Menschen in Deutschland helfen. Denn eine stabile europäische Währung ist ein außerordentlich hohes Gut.
C'est aussi bien Madame Merkel que moi-même. Jamais, vous m'entendez, jamais nous ne laisserons tomber l'euro. Jamais.
然而，援助陷入危机的国家可能只是欧盟领导者的一厢情愿。据路透社报道，根据2011年的一份调查显示，有1/3的德国民众反对援助。同年，法国《费加罗报》报道，有89%的被调查者认为援助债务危机国是烧钱，因为这些国家根本无法偿还。为改变僵局，荷兰首相马克·吕特就曾在去年11月访问英国时重申， 引进欧元区退出机制是一些国家可以退出欧元区。对此，英国《卫报》分析家认为，荷兰一向被市场认为是最拥护欧元区的国家之一。当前形势下发表此言论，视为火上浇油，可能将欧元区分裂变为现实。
The reality is that there are more advanced economies in Europe, within the EU, and there are less developed. There are those that fall far behind. And to make that work, rich countries will have to bail out less competitive countries. Do you think the people of all these countries will accept that as a fact?
What they do accept is that the euro is integral, and we cannot have a situation in which the euro would go away. We need the euro for our prosperity. That's what people understand. At the same time, what we need countries like Greece, Italy, Spain, Portugal, Ireland, what we need them to do is to get their public finances in order, to get their competitiveness in order. And as long as that takes place, and mind you, we have a new government in Italy, a new government in Greece, a new government in Spain, they are putting in place severe packages to reform their economies. As long as that takes place, I can explain to the Dutch people that we need to help these countries. If they would not take these measures, it would be extremely difficult. So they now have to accept that we came to some deals with the Stability and Growth Pact, and when we introduced the euro, and this means that they have to live up to those expectations. And that is what is now happening. Far too late. But at least it is happening now.
So you're saying that Dutch people will be with you in helping these troubled countries so long as these countries make the right choices?
Well, when you take a look at the opinion polls, I'm not that successful. Particularly with Greece, many people in the Netherlands feel that we should not help Greece. I believe that we need to help Greece, and I will explain this always in Parliament and on television, in our interest, in our national interest. When you would have an opinion poll on the wider issue of the euro and the fact that we have the stability funds at the European level, it's my opinion that, at least in the opinion polls, people will be more willing to accept these policies. Particularly with Greece, it has always been difficult to carry the population along. And this is always the task of a politician, to sometimes do things in the national interest, even if the population is not agreeing.
What about the more urgent discussions, such as an exit mechanism for certain troubled countries, or maybe divide the eurozone into two parts, the north and the south, something more creative to make things work?
Well, I'm against a northern European currency offset against a southern European currency. I believe we should have the euro as it is, with the, if possible, with the 17. I do believe it is important to have the instrument available for a country which is consistently not implementing the necessary measures to tell such a colleague to leave the eurozone. I believe we should have that instrument. It is not there at the moment. I also believe we should have the instrument available of taking away the voting rights of that particular country at the European table, where the European decisions are being made, in the European Council with the heads of state and government. That we should have. And I think we are gradually working on the European project. I am not in favor of giving out more sovereignty towards the European Union from the member states. I think we have done enough of that, and we now should make use of all these possibilities at the European level. And that's what we are at this moment doing by implementing the Stability and Growth Pact now completely and not just a part of it.
Or the discussion about a pan-Europe fiscal union, greater political integration.
What I want for countries, particularly in the south of Europe, is to accept that when they entered the euro, they also entered a club with certain rules, certain engagements, certain promises, which they now have to uphold. And that's why we have now these debates on a new fiscal compact at the European level, a basically rule-based stability and growth pact with a strong role for the European Commission to tell countries which do not live up to their to what they have promised, that they have to do this, that, and the other. And if not, that sanctions can be applied. Only then the euro can be successful, is my opinion.
无休无止的欧债危机让欧盟的缺陷暴露无遗。 欧盟各国领导人在充当救国队长，熄灭欧债危机这把烈火的同时，也都在深深思考着如何把欧盟各国带入另一个崭新的春天。于是，改革成了最有力的杀手锏。
It's now important not to lose momentum and to swiftly implement all those decisions that have been taken to put the euro area economy back on course.
Für uns heute heißt das, wir müssen die Struktur der Europäischen Union weiterentwickeln. Und das heißt nicht weniger Europa, sondern das heißt mehr Europa. Das heißt, Europa so aufzubauen, dass der Euro eine Zukunft hat, liebe Freunde.
对于慵懒已久的欧盟各国来说，解决结构改革和财政紧缩问题自然是当务之急。但欧盟会走到今天，仅仅是因为这些吗？
Malheureusement, à Amsterdam, on s'est focalisé uniquement sur la partie monétaire. Et donc, l'Union monétaire a bien fonctionné pendant 10 ans, mais sur une jambe. Et dès qu'il y a eu des difficultés, on a vu ce qu'il en était. Et puis, il y a aussi le manque d'esprit de coopération.
持有同样想法的还有荷兰首相马克吕特。他表示，欧盟成员需要缩减不必要的繁文缛节，相互打开市场才是关键。
The system is, of course, far from being perfect. It is an experiment, Euro, and you need to constantly amend the rules and regulation and try to make it relevant. and workable. What do you think are some of the imperatives?
Well, imperative is more jobs, more prosperity, and we need to reform Europe. And we have a common market, which is too small at the moment. We need to open the market for services, for the IT sector, for the telecommunications sector. We need to deregulate our European market. There's too much red tape at the moment. Which
within the EU members?
Yeah, well, take IKEA. You know the IKEA furniture firm, big brand from Sweden. It is Swedish. And when they would open a shop in your country, it takes them 7 months to do so, from planning to opening. When they will do the same in the European Union, it takes 7 years. So this is unsustainable. So we need to bring this down, and we need to get that red tape out of the system.
I did not know or expect that there will be so many red tape still within the EU members, among the EU members themselves.
Too much. And therefore, I always benchmark against Asia. And my question is, why is it possible in China to do this in 7 months, while it takes us here 7 years to open a shop?
Open a shop of IKEA in the Netherlands, so to speak.
Well, in the Netherlands, I hope and I even know that we will do it quicker. This is at the European level, so the average of Europe is about 7 years to open an IKEA shop.
荷兰属于外向型经济， 60% 以上的产品被出口到世界各地， 是一个名副其实的欧洲中转站。 在欧债危机阴云不散的情况下， 国际评级公司又不断火上浇油。 今年 1月13号， 标普宣布下调9个欧元区国家的信用评级， 作为荷兰主要出口对象之一的法国， 此次也惨遭降级。 面对如此情形， 虽然荷兰仍保持3A评级， 但周围已经是四面楚歌。 荷兰中央银行去年12月公布的报告显示， 荷兰经济将于2012年陷于停滞， 经济增长率为 0.2%， 失业率上升至 5.3%。 荷兰首相马克吕特也表示， 未来是荷兰非常艰难的一年。
When we take a look at the Dutch economy, the prospects is very mixed. What's your personal guess or personal prediction of where the Dutch economy will be going?
2012 will be a difficult year. We need to put in place austerity packages to get the public finances in order, which is partly because we want to keep the trust of the money markets, of the bond markets. Mm. It's important to keep our ratings as they are, and because that reflects also in our interest rates, and it results in low interest rates, which is good in itself for the public finances. So that is a system which we want to keep in place. So and that will be one part of this year. At the same time, we need to take all kinds of measures to get economic growth going. So at the moment, my colleague Maxime Verhagen, who is the minister for the economy, he is bringing together universities, companies, the government. We have the 10 top sectors in which we excel, like agriculture, like water management. So we have the creative industries. These are sectors of the economy in which we have a particular strength, and we want to bring together all the big players from innovation, from the companies, and from the government to come to actionable agendas. So not big meetings with large piles of paper. No, actionable agendas which can be implemented as soon as possible, and that's what we are doing now. So this has already led to 1.5 billion more private investment in R&D than we had a year ago, which is an important measure of is your business life willing to invest in the national economy. So that's taking a good course at the moment. Together with some of our neighboring countries, we are going through a rough phase. So 2012 will be a tough year. The underlying strength of the Dutch economy is huge. We are one of the strongest economies, relatively speaking, one of the strongest economies in the world, and we are as export-driven as China. So there we are much alike in terms of the percentage of our national income which is exported to other countries.
But this time, can you export your way out?
My view is more exports outside the European Union to countries like yourselves and others, where we will have I'm going to South Africa on the trade mission later on. So we also I was in Russia last year on a big trade mission. The Queen was in Oman and the Arab Emirates a week ago. So we're constantly now, obviously, we keep on focusing on the European Union colleagues, but we're also very much interested in the very fast-growing Asian, South African and Latin American economies.
And at the same time, you will try to boost spending back home?
Well, we have to cut the public spending, and at the same time, we need to boost the private investments, particularly in research and development. We are very much a trading nation. We have historically not a very big industrial sector. We have a strong industrial sector, but it is as a percentage of the overall national income, it is relatively modest. And we try to get some boosts there and to learn from what we have done in the agricultural sector. We have the Wageningen University working together with the total chain of firms and industries and government agencies within the agricultural sector. And It is something that constantly people from China and from other Asian countries are visiting the Netherlands to learn from what we are doing there. So that is in itself a very strong branch of our economy, and we can learn from that model the fact that they work so well together in other sectors. So to do more with the same amount of money, because a lot of extra investments, particularly from the government, are not expected because of the fact that we have to put these savings into place to get our public finances in order.
荷兰这个国家自由而且宽容，充满了无限的创意气息。虽然荷兰是欧洲国土面积比较小的国家之一，但是呢，早在17世纪，这个小小的国家就拥有了世界上最强大的舰队，几乎垄断了全球的远洋贸易，成为了一个前所未有的商业帝国。直到今天，无论在艺术、创意还是商业规则等等领域，我们都能够找到荷兰人曾经给世界留下的足迹。45岁的马克·吕特在欧洲呢，算是一位年轻的首相，一位年轻的领导者。在我专访他的过程当中呢，他表现出了高于他年龄的睿智和成熟，他总是能一针见血地指出问题的症结所在。在专访中，他提到17世纪荷兰繁荣的终结，正是因为当时的荷兰人过于的急功近利。而正是这种心态呢，也导致了2008年金融危机。所以说呢，如何不要重蹈覆辙，如何避免资源过度的流向金融领域，如何避免产业的空心化，这是全球各国政府都需要深刻思考和持续关注的话题。欧债危机呢还远没有结束，发生在欧盟成员国之间的争吵也远远没有停止。欧元区国家在实施紧缩政策的同时，更应该关注成员国之间的市场开放制度。好，今天的领导者节目就是这些，我是魏成刚，我们下周同一时间再见。